How many of you have already chanted 32 rounds? Shamsundar is back. Watch, he'll probably break the 3 digits today. He likes chanting. More than he likes. Chanting likes him too. How many of you, during your morning activities, maybe even when you woke up, maybe even in your sleep, Govinda Damodara Madhavi Ji. Me too. Names. Melody. The names. Bill Mangala Thakur. Giving his association that way. Very special. So, continuing this morning from this Nectar of Instruction, Text 7, which you'll see shortly. We heard on Friday evening about this song we just sang, and shortly there'll be a little dramatic reading of the translation, which you'll hear much better than yesterday morning. But the theme is two things, same as Saturday morning. The name and the person named are identical. Coming from, based upon Padma Purana, Abhinatam Nama Namino, one of our famous and favorite verses about chanting. Nama Chintamani Krishna, that verse. Abhinatam Nama Namino, there's the quality of non-difference name and the object name. So the language that Bhaktivinoda Thakur uses includes that, but also bhajan, bhajaka. It means the same. The name and the object named by the name. And they're identical. At the same time they're identical, one is more merciful than the other, although they're identical. Something like saying, Lord Chaitanya and Krishna are the same. Lord Chaitanya is Krishna himself. Krishna is Chaitanya, Chaitanya is Krishna, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is more merciful. Sounds like a contradiction. It's not. It's that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu manifests the fullness of Krishna's mercy, and Krishna has fullness of mercy, and he makes a requirement. It's rendered to be. The name doesn't make that requirement. The fullness of the mercy of Ramaprabhu is there. And that saying that the name form, we heard in the previous song, Namaste Katu, the form of the two syllables. That's interesting because we're not accustomed to thinking of sound having form. But sound has form, at least spiritual sound has form. I learned something a few weeks ago when visiting in Alachua. One of the devotees during the question and answer session brought up, this is science says, so it's got to be true, right? Empiric evidence that verifies spiritual sound has form. Ready? Science says. So in the early 1900s, there was one scientist, I forget his name, and he spent 30 years developing a technology showed, demonstrated the effect of sound on matter. And an experiment went like this. Very, 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 very detailed. So he had a, this is called a tonoscope, something like a funnel or a tube, that on this side there's a sound that's projected through the tonoscope, and on the other side there's a membrane that has powder of some kind. And the experiment was to show what the effect on configuration of the powder on the membrane with material, and in his case specifically Sanskrit sound, which is spiritual sound, although the subject matter may be so many things. The source is spiritual, the sound is spiritual, and he found, and it, you know, statistically documents and published things, when material sound is passed through the tonoscope, the powder on the membrane is scattered. When Sanskrit sound is projected from one end towards the membrane, after some time, the powder forms the Devanagari symbols. He had to get people that knew how to pronounce Sanskrit properly. He got somebody who pronounced Om properly, and the configuration of powder showed the Om symbol. Interesting. 30 years. I'm surprised more people don't know about it. But Sanskrit sound is a spiritual sound different than material sound. You'll hear again this evening, technology permitting, this little statement, little video clip of Srila Prabhupada saying the same thing. This is not a material sound. It's a spiritual sound. Or how do we hear, yesterday we heard Bhakti Siddhanta speaking or writing, we just read and wrote. Spiritual sound heard with a material ear sounds like material sound. But it's not material sound. But we perceive it that way because we're hearing with material conception and thus the material type of hearing. But like Bada Hari said at the very beginning, the Govinda Damodar Stotra, there's a spiritual ear because the soul has form, and the soul has ear, and the soul has tongue, or the capacity to make sound. So if we hear with the spiritual ear, you know, what's our qualification to hear with spiritual ear? It's purification, endeavor, and mercy. Then we can hear with spiritual ear, and then we can understand who Krishna really is. That's our opportunity. And as Bhakti Siddhanta said, it's otherwise not possible. No. Hareer Nama, Hareer Nama, Hareer Nama, Eva Kekavam Golo, Nasteva, Nasteva, Nasteva. It's only possible through sound. And specifically, the name, of course, Namadi, Nam, etc. But it starts with the sound of the name. We'll hear Prabhupada say in his words, this evening, technology. So the mercifulness of the name built into the song, we'll hear shortly, is if you offend the spiritual form, meaning the Swarupa deity form or the other than the name form, the spiritual form, the Swarupa Krishna, Krishna Swarupa, there's an offense. And the offense thus created can be removed by the name. there's seva aparada. We don't deliberately, but it accidentally, if there is some seva aparada. Rupa Goswami teaches, and this song is teaching, the name has the power to remove that offense. We don't make offense to the name, saying, hey, it's okay, I can make seva aparada, just chant. Or I can sin, just chant, or I can, etc., etc. So that's aparada, nama aparada. But if there's seva aparada, we're rescued by the name, and therefore the name is more merciful. And the theme, almost done, the preview of the meaning of the song, goes right to the last line of Nectar of Instruction, text 7, where up to the root, because the root is offense. The name. Up to the root is carefully chanted, has the capacity to remove material existence, remove the avidya, the disease of material existence, and the suffering that goes along with it. Okay, let's see how the sound volume is working.
O Lord, you possess two transcendental forms, properly called Vachya, that which is nameable, and Vachaka, that which denotes. The Vachya is your beautiful personal bodily form, full of transcendental knowledge and bliss. The Vachaka forms are your holy names, such as Sri Krishna and so forth. Thus, appearing in the form of transcendental sound vibration, you are the resting place for the bliss of all souls. Your unlimited manifestations are found in these two forms. Taking pity and being very kind, they confer upon the fallen souls entrance into your divine pastimes. But of these two forms of yours, O Lord, I have understood your Vachaka form to be even more merciful than your Vachya form. Thus do I find your holy name most wonderful. It is the declaration of the Vedas that the holy name of the Lord and the Lord himself are non-different. Yet, still, the holy name is more merciful than the Lord himself. If one is an offender to Lord Krishna personally, but has genuine faith in the holy name and calls out with all his heart and soul, Rama, Krishna, Hari, Rama, Krishna, Hari, Rama, Krishna, Hari. Then all his offenses are cast far away and he floats without difficulty in the ocean of divine bliss and transcendental mellows. A person may commit offenses to the Vachya or the transcendental figure of the Lord. But if he is under the shelter of the pure holy name, he crosses over all those offenses. At the lotus feet of Srila Rupa Goswami, Bhakti Vinoda begs for constant loving attachment for the Vachaka or divine holy name of the Supreme Lord.
Here he's praying for constant loving attachment. So how do we get constant loving attachment? Well, we're attached to the temporary, and we need mercy to become effort as well, but to become free from attachment to the temporary and transfer that tendency for attachment, which is of the soul, naturally to be attached to the Supreme. And the most merciful form of the Supreme is the name. Powerful song. So I'm just going to go through it quickly. This is without the dramatic reading. But he's teaching in a song form that these two, Vacha and Vachaka, are both forms. The sound is not a form, the sound is form. Transcendental form, transcendental sound is form. And the Vacha is this nice painting of Krishna and Dwarka when he saw his reflection in the polished marble in Dwarka. He was stunned to see the beauty of that form. Satchitananda is in fullness, that's Krishna. And the Vachaka form is a sound vibration. And Krishna, the sound vibration, is a resting place for the bliss of all souls. So is it the Vacha, but both. Resting place for the bliss. That's where awakening Nama Rasa, the title of this It's within the name, it's within the form, it's within Krishna. He is the resting place of all ananda, those spirits of bliss. Again, these two forms are there, and both appear in this world to attract the souls, and either, both, confer upon fallen souls entrance into your divine pastimes. That's high. Enter into the pastime of Krishna through sound. What's our qualification? But the name is very merciful. So both of these forms confer the same, but the Vajika form, more merciful, although they're both the same, more merciful is the name, and here's the rationale or the explanation in the song. If we form, we offend personal form, yet we call, have with faith, genuine faith, with heart and soul, the name, those reactions, the offenses, aparad, results in anarthas or unwanted things of the heart. How do you get rid of them? It's a science. It's science of devotion. I'll say one additional thing besides just what's in the song. Both Bhaktivinoda and Jiva Goswami, Bhaktivinoda following the teachings of Jiva Goswami from Bhakti Siddhartha, explains the name is like the sun. It's unlimitedly luminous. And that which can block the luminous nature of the sun is mist and clouds. So Bhaktivinoda uses this mist of ignorance and the clouds of anarthas. So anyone that's seen fog or mist, when you're in the, covered by fog or something, the brightness of the sun is not experienced. The full heat of the sun is not experienced. But fog is more readily removed, and at a certain point, poof, the fog is gone. Just Niharam Iva Bhaskaram, in the language of Bhagavad Gita. That the sins produce ignorance, and that ignorance is dismissed. Sins arise from ignorance, and they perpetrate further ignorance of idiot. But then clouds are more difficult. The teaching is, clouds have the power to block the power of the sun. So how do you remove the clouds of anarthas? We're hearing it. They're carefully chanting. It has its meaning. And in his previous verse, with faith, genuine faith, small thing, and with heart and soul, we spoke about alignment of body, mind, heart. So call out from the soul. This is Bhakti Siddhanta's language of hear with spiritual ear. And we have spiritual ears. We have to go beyond the material hearing. We have to strive. We need mercy. But when that happens, the anarthas in the heart, poof, or at least gradually, in installments. So it's not a one time. I remember one day I tried to chant very sincerely and it was nice. But we have to continue trying. And sometimes the light of the sun comes more, sometimes the light comes less. That's in Krishna's hand. We continue with faith, heart and soul calling, and the whole covering is gone. And repeating, the reactions and offenses, which are anarthas, become clear through the name. Therefore, Bhakti Goda begging for constant loving attachment for the divine name. That's a nice teaching to contemplate as we're going forward. And the lotus of the heart unfolds. This is fast motion, but like a flower opens in the brilliance of the sun, this is this teaching of spiritual empowerment where the Ladini and the Samhit potency descend on Bhakti Devi to reveal to the Jiva the full rasa of the name and the Jiva's spiritual form. This is Bhakti Vinod's teaching in relation to the chanting of the name. So it's accessible even when we're distracted. But we're not getting the fullness because we're distracted. The potency isn't diminished by the sun because there's clouds in the sky and different thicknesses of the clouds or density of clouds. With faith continuing carefully on the process, we have the opportunity then to experience who Krishna really is. And experiencing that is through the form of the name, the Absolute Truth, Lord Krishna. This is the teaching, possesses an eternal form of sacred syllables. It's in Harinam Chintamani, it's in what we heard yesterday. Within the name, Nama, Rupa, Guna Lila, it's not that the name chanted nicely, then over there you experience the form, because the name has form. Within the name is form. And within the name, qualities of Krishna within the name, and the pastimes of Krishna within the name. And one can enter into the pastimes of Krishna through the name. Read carefully. Ooh, difficult going, but Brahma Samhita says the same thing. Mantra upasana and swarasati, just through sound vibration, one can see and one can enter into the pastime self. One can understand, one can see, and the understanding is Krishna reveals himself, and we can understand. What do we really want? You know, we're mixed. Don't smoke. You're gradual. But if there's faith in the teachings and our teachers who are giving us these teachings, and ultimately the scripture is the basis of what the teachers and the teachings they're giving, there's no limit. What's the limit of Krishna's mercy? What's the limit of Krishna's mercy, of Krishna's name? What an opportunity. And who are we? Distracted jivas. Wanting, you know, less suffering, please. Or something. Something. So there has to be a re-evaluation again and again. Again and again, and again and again. In the association of sadhus, this is what Chaitanya's teaching, to help us get to that stage where we want the really real thing permanently. Every one of us has that, and every one of us has some mix. So the opportunity is to go beyond the mix. We see the reflection is like a damned tree. We see the temporary, that according to scripture, it's asat, because it's temporary. But then that asat is a reflection of sat. But we need to pay attention to sat. And then we can understand asat properly, relate to it properly, and navigate our way through asat properly. you know, the good fortune, ill fortune, the happiness and distress, the duality of material existence. We all are very familiar with the duality, and it's a reflection of the non-dual spiritual realm. And access into that is through the name. So here's our theme song for this event. Let's sing it or say it together. Ya Krishna Chaitanya Sita Priyamya Vito Patata Yasanasya Narochita Nu Kintva Dharata Vinam Patasya Yadashisana Svadhi Ramana Vyakta Vrho Vahantri. Again, there's the big letters. Taj Gada Mula Hanchi. Mula means root. Vegetable in India, everyone knows it's mula. So, mula means root. And one can uproot this avidya completely. Once you uproot a weed and toss it, shake off the dirt and cling to the root, it dries up. But you have to pull through. So we can't. The message is, we can't do this on our own. And, you know, anyone that's really tried knows you can't do it on your own. Just like Bhakti Siddhanta said yesterday, to understand the non-difference of name and the object named, we can't do it on our own. We have a binary processor mind. So what's the non-dual mind? Where we see the non-dual existence of the name and the object name. It's theory. I've had many discussions with devotees, very honestly trying this, just like the exercise we mentioned Saturday morning and Saturday evening, and mentioning it again, it's in the handout. Contemplate the name and the object name, nama nami, are the same. Well, the binary processor mind can't. It just doesn't, it bounces, honestly. But you meditate on it. That's the teaching of Rupa Goswami, the inactive part of Shila, or Shila. The contemplation upon, that's the spiritual mind on the non-difference of the sound and the object named by that sound. In the mood of being in service to the name, because that's who we are, we're service of Krishna. And we're accessing Krishna through the name. Here's Prabhupada's translation again. The holy name, character, pastimes and activities of Krishna are all transcendentally sweet, like sugar candy. Although the tongue of one afflicted by the jaundice of avidya cannot taste anything sweet, it is wonderful. But simply by carefully chanting these sweet names every day, a natural relish awakens within the tongue, and his disease, avidya, is gradually destroyed at the root. So what's this root of the disease? It's offense. That's the disease. There's sin that generates mist of ignorance, but when we act with ignorance, not only sinful activity, but that which is spiritual, we don't see as spiritual, and we're interacting with that which is spiritual, and it's an offense against the name. Nama parat. So there's 10 offenses. They're in your handout. But there's a root to the tree of offense, That means the resolution of the root of offense is attentiveness. The mind will be conquered by Nama, Krishna in the form of the holy name, namely Nami, not by our own effort alone. Same teaching we've heard, it's just explicitly presented by our acharyas. If one is an offender to Lord Krishna personally, but has genuine faith in the holy name and calls out with all his heart and soul, Rama, Krishna, Hari, then all his offenses are cast far away. So this is direct reference to the verse we sang, Namastika 6. But we can't conquer our mind alone. We require mercy. It is required. And the mercy of the name. So we call for the mercy of the name. This is from Harinam Chintamani. Again, discussion between Lord Chaitanya and Haridas Thakur. Simply by one's own effort, no one in this material world can overcome inattention. Such a victory can only come by your merciful blessings. So, the holy name is present in all the four yugas. The specialness of the holy name Kali Yuga, because it's the Yuga Dharma, is the blessing of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. We're so fortunate. We have that connection with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And on his order to do so, we're trying. Maybe sometimes more, sometimes less, but we're trying. There's faith just in our trying, just in our chanting, even the mechanical, distracted kind. There's some faith. So let us call for Lord Chaitanya and the name for experiencing the fullness of that mercy. One of my favorite texts, there's been several in this presentation of Rupa Goswami. This is not from Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. This is from Vidanta Madhava, where he is speaking about the holy name. I was with Dravida recently. He not only knows the Sanskrit, but he has his own translation, his own poetization of this verse. It's very nice. But three steps, the tongue, the ear, and the heart. It's alignment, the tongue, body, the ear, the auditory sense, it goes to the mind. And so the mind or the heart. So I do not know how much nectar the two syllables Krishna have produced. When the holy name Krishna is chanted, it appears to dance within the mouth. We then desire many, many mouths. This is Rupa Goswami's chanting. When that name enters the holes of the ears, we desire many millions of ears. From the tongue to the ear to the heart. And when the holy name dances in the courtyard of the heart, here we go, it conquers the activities of the mind. And therefore all the senses become inert. Any yoga system requires control of the mind and senses. Any kind of spiritual elevation, even material elevation, requires controlling the mind and senses. When somebody really focused on whatever they're focused on, their Olympic sport, or professional sport, or academic pursuit, or something. A scientist that wants to invent something. So much sacrifice. The mind and senses can be brought into a position of focus upon even something material, what to speak of, the all-attractive. Then the mind can become controlled, or captured, or inert. And when the mind becomes inert, the senses, the activities of the mind are conquered, the senses become inert. So, obstacles in all of this, back to reality, our current experience. We need these two things, control of the mind, which we've been discussing, and the mood of submission unto the name and the deliverer of the name, ultimately Lord Chaitanya, but our immediate deliverer of the name is just fine. And we heard from Bhaktisiddhanta, and it's repeating now, the solution is hearing. So here's some little things that may help you during our 64 round day. Stop thinking, start hearing. Neglect the mind, distraction, and turn the mind to the sound. Or this kind of vernacular, don't space out. Hear. Or just surrender to the sound vibration of the holy name. Please, just hear, hear, hear. The mind gets distracted. Please, hear. And it conquers the distraction. So there's our theme. This is a methodology for awakening. Namarasa comes through sound into the ear. And otherwise, yeah, okay.
Maharaj, what exactly means surrender in terms of holy name?
We submit ourselves. That in this topic, remember from yesterday, Satchidananda Swami, the Atmanivedita, give my whole self to the name. Sharanagati, surrender. I give myself to the name. I am your servant. Now that was a previous one also, the mood of service. And you know, no reservation. Not partial. Surrender can be partial, and surrender can be complete.
So you mean that developing that mood of the service to the Holy Name means surrender? In the
yes. And as it matures, as surrender and submission, the mood of service matures, then it's full surrender. So we're not at full surrender capacity yet. Surrender. And that full capacity. There's a mix. Yes. Spiritual comes the physical.
Yes, so you would go from being dimensionally where we are, which would be a 2D DNA
yes.
person,
yes.
to a multi-DNA.
A multi?
So, yeah. So
multi, what was the word after multi?
Mm-hmm.
Multi-DNA, did you say?
Change DNA? Does it go from 2 DNAs to multidimensional.
Oh, I don't
which
know.
Is
I do know this though. The neurology of the spiritual sound vibration, the neurological system changes. I don't know about DNA. So you can guess about that one, but I don't, and my answer is I don't know. The neurology changes. Multiple experiments.
And that allows us to hear. Spirits.
Yes. But yes, the matter reconfigures itself. Matter reconfigures not itself, but this the touch of spirit reconfigures the material arrangement, the neurology of the covering, the body.
This is so cool, I just love it.
So maybe DNA changes, I don't know, multidimensional, that's like interesting speculation.
Right, and that's our language.
Yeah, okay, but let's just do neurology because it's verifiable.
Neurology, okay.
That's our sensory apparatus works through neurology and how the brain processes stuff. Sensory input, it changes permanently. Multiple experiments on that, published in scientific journals. Specifically, one of the experimenters was a Spanish neurologist who, during his career as a neurologist, had a side fascination with Sanskrit. So he learned on his own, he learned Sanskrit. And when he retired, he went to India to learn Sanskrit more and used his neurology, MRI, CAT scan, this and that, the other thing, skills, to see what happens to the neurological arrangement of a human being that chants Sanskrit a lot. Not even the name, just Sanskrit. And neurology changes. He calls it, in his published articles are called the Sanskrit effect. You can just Google that one. You'll probably find, you know, the name of the scholar. I don't remember his name. The Sanskrit effect. And one of the Sanskrit effects is memory increases 3 to 4 times. It's Kali Yuga. And memory diminishes. But those who chant Sanskrit with faith, it means you have to have faith to do it several hours a day, their neurology changes. The capacity of the brain comes from the soul. It comes from the super soul. That's Bhagavad Gita. So the neurology, you get, you know, different apparatus. You get different hardware. The hardware changes. Not only the waves of the brain waves change, your hardware changes in this lifetime. Pretty cool. And capacity goes beyond what it was before the Sanskrit effect. Doesn't say anything about DNA, multiple dimension. So, anything else? Because otherwise, oh, yes.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. So, as Syamasundara Prabhu told us, concentrating on the syllables, the name-letter syllables or the Maha Mantra.
Yeah.
So you're focusing on the visual portion of it. And what you're saying is the mind is not a dual object. So is it only like when you are uttering, you just hear, or also you visualize?
Whatever works.
Okay.
What he suggested is not his invention. There's great acharyas in our line of disciplic succession that did exactly that. It's got a name, Tratika, without the details of who did it. It's a standard. So the Devanagari, and even if it's the English of the Devanagari, there's potency in that, you know, form, just like, you know, the paintings. its form. But the purpose is not just to see, it's to hear. Whatever helps hearing, that you do that one. Don't get lost in the vision. Get into, if it helps your hearing, do it. If it distracts your hearing, you might want to consider dropping that one and just hearing. But if it helps your hearing, you do it. He's sharing, it helps him. Fantastic. You know, sweet dreams. He looks at the words before he takes rest and sees it in his dreams. Pretty fantastic. Yeah.
Maharaj, I often have this dilemma of like finishing japa versus inattentive chanting, meaning I have a few runs to finish, but the place and time is not very congenial for chanting. And then after that, I feel a bit happy about finishing, but then not so happy about attentive part. So then the question arises, is quality chanting more important or finishing the rounds is important?
Both are important. And numerical chanting is very important. Quality chanting, one could say, is more important, but we at minimum, chanting, resting upon the Sad Goswami Astaka that says they as acharyas they did. It's what, like when Lord Chaitanya did. What does Lord Chaitanya need? But one of the arguments that he needed someone to travel with, one hand was on his feet, the other hand were on his counter. Someone has to carry your cloth and your water pot. Take one servant with you. Lord Chaitanya did, the six Goswamis did, are we better? They're teaching by example. They don't need, but they're teaching by example. So numerical chanting is really important. I think we all know the feeling, but the answer is numerical chanting is a must. Until you get to quality chanting, numerical chanting. Make every effort so that the solution long term is chant early in the morning before your busy day starts. And that can't always happen because sometimes circumstance you're up at night. Some devotees I know, they get up early in the morning regardless of what time they take rest because of their because the importance they play. And then, anyway, different people have different ways they handle irregular, circumstances. Take a nap during the day or just push themselves for that day or something. But Hari, you want to add anything to this? You like this song, I know.
I like the song. I was just thinking, Prabhupada, I've heard in his lectures where he'll say 3 or 4 times, in a paragraph, numerical strength, which is another way of, even though the quality's not there, there's strength in doing it.
Just like our 64 rounds.
Yeah, there's strength. Just that he did it, and Krishna sees that you're trying.
It's a commitment to the relationship. And when you have a commitment to a relationship, you don't check out of the relationship because your attention's over there. You stay with the relationship even if it's not at its peak because the relationship is important to you. The commitment to the relationship. Chancellor, do you want to add anything? Okay. So how many here are planning or hoping or wishing Krishna's mercy to complete 64 rounds? You have a small child, it's not going to be easy. So if you can, please do. If you can't, that's just fine. Not like you're another category over there. And Shyam Sundar will be with you. Where are you going to, it doesn't say where. Just in the office? Okay. When that schedule, part of our schedule comes up, that's where you go. You're intending find yourself that you're not in 64 and you want some nice association, specific to the chanting of the name. A reminder, two reminders. Mona Vrata, the real test, as soon as we're done, we don't have conversation. When you're having prasadam, you don't have conversation. If you have small children, you have to have some conversation, but you do it softly and quietly and carefully. And the other is, just from experience, eat modestly, less than what you normally would, whatever that is, because when you're sitting or even you're walking, when you're doing this activity, your metabolism is a little different, and the digestive power is a little